Hello and welcome to episode 10 of The Second Messiah. On the last episode, Vithericus was conquering more territory from the Kingdom of Aksum, defeating their large naval force which landed at their last stronghold with relative ease by cutting them off before they could reach the town and then conquering the rest of their territory. Back in Attila with Saphrax, the Romans have been pretty much pushed off the peninsula. Now it's a massive patchwork of different factions vying for control of the region. Vithericus had to head back south to deal with an invasion by the Kingdom of Nobatia. Unfortunately for the enemy, they brought a very unversatile force and were able to be tempted into attacking uphill against Vithericus's superior infantry. Overall, the situation went very well for Vithericus and his army. The invasion was wiped out and he now plans a counterattack.
You probably think I'm afraid of dying. The truth is that death would be a welcome release from this mess if I were just a common man. But as it stands, the mess my people are in is one I have led them to, and I'll be damned if I'm going to leave them in it. I need my strength back, strength enough for a campaign. We need to secure lands beyond our walls or we'll forever live in fear of destruction. And you know, thinking about being on the march again, walking side by side with my warriors, knowing that they'll do all it takes to see my mission completed. Just the thought makes me feel better already. Yes, I have to do something. At least try to go out with a bang. I can't let little weasel Eutharic think he controls the place. The more lands outside of Tarentum we hold, the more lands will be in the hands of true Goths, not the disgraced Romans. He thinks he deserves his power, but if it weren't for the sake of keeping the peace, I would have his head. I can't believe I let him fool me into thinking it was possible to take their empire for myself. Well, as I said, the least I can do is end my life doing something that makes the struggle of my people easier. That is what His Highness Vithmiris would have wanted, and perhaps, if he is alive, what Vithericus would want as well.
So Vithericus has defeated the Nobatian invasion. It was a pretty easy victory, you might remember. Their king didn't give them the best of commands and they lost most of their men very rapidly. Our force coming off looking okay. Plus, we're going to get really good replenishment by taking on warriors from the survivors. Unfortunately, the enemy's army wasn't totally destroyed, so we'll have to use up a few more movement points to finish them off. Should be easy, though. We can just auto-resolve that. The defeat of this army means that as far as we know, and as far as is likely, the Nobatians are now destroyed in terms of their military power. So unless they happen to have another army defending their settlement, we should be free to make an attack and thus unify the region of Ethiopia. You can see for this battle, interestingly, Guillemet is taking his first steps onto the battlefield, bringing out some Roman troops from the city. He commands Legio. Because the Ostrogoths are the inheritors of Rome, it's one of their traits, we are able to command a few Roman troops, and they're often in the garrisons. So there we go. The Nobatian army is wiped out, and will now be ready to move back north to attack them. I have Amalric, our spy, just there to the north, who should be able to go and take a look and find out if they do have any more forces. I'm assuming they won't. There's their town up there. It's a couple of turns of movement away, so it's even possible they'll build up something before I get there, if they have the money to do so. So moving through the desert, we don't encounter any more forces. Even right up to the city, there's nothing. So unless their armies happen to be somewhere else, it looks like their town's going to be undefended. I can just march right to it with Vithericus. The problem is that the territory we're leaving behind isn't in a very good state. New Eden is currently plagued by disease, and you can see public order is deteriorating from its already low state, meaning we're extremely likely to face a rebellion after this turn. The people are not happy about this new state of affairs. We're forcing Arian Christianity on them as well, which they're probably not too enthusiastic about. So depending on where the rebel army spawns, this may affect my ability to go and attack the Nobatians, because I might have to, say, move south first to take out the rebels, which could be inconvenient. You can see that some of the Eastern-style buildings here are actually better than the ones I can convert them to, so I'm going to just conveniently leave a lot of them as they are in order to get some sanitation boosts there. So now back to Saphrax in Attalia. We're still holding on to Tarentum, which is now pretty stable, and I'm thinking of moving out to take a new territory. My prime candidate is Syracuse, down to the southwest. It's part of the same province of Tarentum, so taking it will help me manage the public order, squalor, and food. And of course, there's no enemies around me here in Tarentum, so I should be free to move and attack that province even though it's a little bit far away. Moving Saphrax out of the town does mean public order is deteriorating here as well, so I can't be gone for too many turns, or at least I need to capture Syracuse and secure public order there. To get to Syracuse easily, I need military access with the Saxons, because they control the land between me and them. Unfortunately, there's no chance of military access by the looks of it, so I'm willing to offer money for this because it would be awfully convenient, but the small amount I'm willing to offer doesn't seem to impress them. I offer a non-aggression pact out of interest, and they say no, so this isn't a very good sign considering the Saxons have a pretty strong holding here in Italia and they don't seem to like me. So I might have to be a little bit careful about how I treat the Saxons. But of course, Syracuse being a coastal city is reachable without using any of the Saxon land. I can go by boat. That might take a little bit longer, but we can still get it in two turns. And that should be enough, possibly, to avoid a rebellion if we're very lucky. So Saphrax is going to try. He needs a new campaign to give him a new lease of life and to expand the influence of the Goths, who are still really teetering on the edge. I can curiously here upgrade my cavalry to a superior version even while at sea. They managed to somehow scavenge the equipment and training resources they needed to do that. Interesting. So Syracuse itself is not in the best of shape, but it's likely very easy to capture at least. So now at the start of the next turn, there is indeed a rebellion in Ethiopia, and Garlamir has a new child, very useful. Eutharic is trying to get himself onto the one of the offices, the political ladder, and I don't think Vithericus, who seems to have the opportunity to block him, would really be up for this. Of course, in my own storyline, Vithericus doesn't even know that this is happening, so we'll have to imagine it's actually Saphrax attempting to block him, but I'm going to go for the block. Eutharic is not going to be allowed up the ranks of the Goths. Now, you might remember Edgica was trying to find a wife, and he appears to have located one. She's intelligent, giving a bunch of really useful traits, and at the same age as well, so it looks like a pretty good match for these two, so I'm going to allow them to marry. So here's the rebellion. It's just east of New Eden, a pretty inconvenient location because I'm going to have to go away from my objective of Nobatia in order to fight it. So Vithericus is simply going to march over there and challenge them to battle. I knew they would run away from this because there's no reason for them to fight, and indeed they run into the mountains further east. Now at this point I could continue to chase them down, but it's in my interest actually to allow this rebellion to grow a bit larger. It does have some good looking units in there, but still it's so numerically inferior to me it's not a problem. But allowing the rebellion to grow larger will improve public order by another 20, meaning if I defeat it next turn we'll be on minus 60 public order rather than minus 80 where we would be if I defeated them now. So I'm going to allow them to grow, still should be able to just auto-resolve to kill them and get that free public order. And with that public order buffer there, I might even be able to avoid another rebellion if we're very lucky. You can see here my work converting this province to Arian Christianity is going quite well. The influence of Arian Christianity is massive, so the people are being converted very quickly, so hopefully that will help out with the public order in the future.
The tyrant king of the north came to our city with one purpose: to enslave a people who he regarded as mere insects beneath his feet. He brought with him his stinking followers, forcing them into our homes, bringing death and foul disease to our families. Now, he seeks to rebuild the city by his own vile plan, sparing no thought for the tens of thousands who called it home. How can any man see all these and not know it is time to fight for a righteous cause? How can anyone stand by and let a sacrilegious monster rule over such an honorable city? How can we forgive anyone who does not take up arms and fight with me to restore our pride, our integrity, and our freedom?
Switching back to Attalia, you can see Saphrax is too late to take Syracuse. It seems that our Italian allies have gone and taken it, perhaps even with help from the Visigoths there. So it looks like I was just slightly too late. One turn earlier and that province would have been mine. Everyone else had the same idea, seeing the weakness of Syracuse. I could move even further west to attempt to take another Western Roman Empire settlement, but the problem there is that I'll definitely face a rebellion back in Tarentum while I'm away. So that's not really going to be a possibility. Saphrax is going to have to return empty-handed and embarrassed to his people just in order to keep things under control back here. We do have lots of construction going on, so the level of public order should slowly even out as our buildings get completed. So now the rebel army has grown indeed bigger, it's time for Vithericus to challenge it again. This time it actually stands and fights despite having a massive disadvantage still. That's convenient for me because it means it uses fewer movement points to finish these guys off, and of course a quick auto resolve should finish them. There we go, entire army destroyed. I actually somehow lost an entire squad of my phalanxmen, which is unfortunate, but at least they were only a mercenary unit, so losing them at least has some financial benefits. So with them defeated, public order is now going to start to increase. Vithericus can move back to Edulis in order to further increase public order for this turn, and then next turn he'll be able to start moving west and north towards the Nobatian capital, which Amalric reports still has no forces in it. It's very curious, the Nobatians aren't bothering to actually rebuild their army after having lost it. Perhaps they've already given up hope. Has some interesting looking buildings, so it'll be very nice to add to Ethiopia and help out with the general management of the province. Now moving back to Attalia, Saphrax doesn't have much to do anymore, he just has to wait. He's sitting here trying to control public order, sanitation's a possible issue, so a Tarentum 2 may face disease at any moment. I am improving sanitation with my new construction, so that's going to improve over time. Unfortunately, Syracuse, which would have helped with the sanitation, isn't going to be ours. The other choice is to take Saxon territory. If we move southwest and take that town Regium, then we'll be able to use that to start improving this province and stop them from converting it to Germanic paganism, which appears to be what they're trying to do down there. For Vithericus, with his turn resting at Edulis over, it's time to move out. You can see public order is still improving even with him outside of the town, so that's excellent news. I can make the situation better by upgrading the town centre I've built at New Eden to further improve public order. We have plenty of food at the moment, so that's not going to be an issue adding to the food consumption. So it looks like Vithericus, as he is 3 turns of regular marching away from his target. I can use forced march to get a little bit closer than I would have done in one turn otherwise, so that if I switch back to a regular march in the next turn, I can reach it then. That will stop the Nobatians from recruiting anything, but since it looks like they're not going to, I don't necessarily need to do this. But of course, no reason to wait around. He has a free space in his army, so I was considering hiring some mercenaries. I ended up deciding to go with the Camel Warriors, because we've seen before, whilst fighting them, they're pretty powerful. We've been quite lucky, actually, in managing to defeat them with missile units, but in melee, they're very good, and especially good as anti-cavalry units. So I thought it might be nice to have that specialist unit in the army alongside my cavalry, as long as my own cav aren't too freaked out by it. So I'm going to hire them in for the attack. Not that I actually need it, but I have so much money that I'm considering hiring these mercenaries in and just keeping them as specialist units. For Saphrax, I had pretty much decided at this point that I was probably just going to attack the Saxons, just drive them out of Attalia and secure the area around me. Their home base is still back up in Saxony itself, so it's unlikely they'll be able to reinforce very easily these little colonies they've taken. The problem with that plan is that Saxons have diplomatic ties. You can see they have 2 defensive allies and a military ally. So declaring war on them could be a little bit dangerous. First, I offered a non-aggression pact just to see if they would actually accept that resolution to our little conflict here. And the chance was low, so it seems they're getting more and more angry with me, or perhaps vice versa. So something is going to have to happen, but if I declare war on them, I'll be called in, their allies will be called in to fight me, unless I can join the Western Roman Empire's war against the Saxons. Using that method, I won't have to fight their allies, and I'll actually get peace with the Western Roman Empire, because I'll have to get peace to do that. Unfortunately, there was no deal where they'll accept peace with me, so all of my missions here have basically failed. I can't go to war with the Saxons legitimately. However, I decided to just trespass in their lands to see what was going on, and noticed that their province is experiencing a rebellion. So it's quite possible that the rebels will take the settlement. I can just sit back in Tarentum and wait, and once it's a rebel province, I can go and take it for myself without having to actually start anything with the Saxons. I'm going to get rid of my mercenaries while I wait to do that and see if that plan works. During the end turn sequence, the Macedonians, who I've been at war with for a long time, supporting my allies the Dacians, who have been attacked by them over and over again, offered me a peace treaty. I was willing to accept it if they gave me a sufficient amount of money, because you can see they're a very weak faction, and they're not a particularly stable faction politically. It seems likely they'll end up going to war with us again. So I ended up actually just saying, no, I'm not going to be at peace with you. I'm going to continue to support my Dacian allies, because the Dacians did actually help me take Tarentum in Attalia. They've been quite useful as an ally. So we're now in the next turn. Saphrax moves out only to discover the rebel army is gone. I don't know whether it attacked the town and failed or whether it just walked off somewhere. There's no way of knowing at this point, but it does mean I shouldn't really get my hopes up by the looks of it. That regime is going to be captured by rebels anytime soon. Now, almost on a whim, I moved north and discovered that Neapolis also has a rebellion. This is a different province, so it actually is rebelling separately to regime. So I might actually have a chance to take Neapolis, and at least that will be something.
Chief Saphrax, I can report that everything is in place. Huthric agreed to the plan, thinking he'll get moved to Neapolis, closer to Rome. Fool. He wants to govern that pile of rubble so bad it is hilarious to see his face when you tell him it's going to happen. Anyway, the weapons and money have been sent. We've got people in every town gathering support for a Roman revival under the protection of you, my lord. The Saxons have only a handful of men, no hope to stop the rebellion once the army gathers. One thing, though. It took a lot of work and a lot of my own money to make this happen. I hope that you will see fit to reward me if this all goes as I claim it will.
Now Vithericus is ready to make his advance. He can get there in one turn of normal stance, rushing up the road there to Pacarus, where he can just destroy the small garrison inside using a protective stance. So, just like that, we've wiped out the surviving elements of the Nobatian kingdom and made them our own. I'll occupy the territory, unifying the province of Ethiopia. We've got all three of the regions now. The town needs a little bit of repair, but otherwise the buildings here are quite useful ones. We'll be able to use some of these to help with our sanitation. Especially in the cases where actually converting the buildings would make things worse off, so a lot of that town's going to remain the same. The bad news though is that in the next turn the disease from New Eden spreads north, so the province of Ethiopia is rapidly being consumed by this disease, and it's not particularly helpful, certainly a bad omen for the people to see this disease spreading. Well, we've got the entire province under control, so at least we have the ability to control the sanitation entirely now. We've got lots of space to use, and the sanitation is generally positive as a result of the buildings. You can see here's another example of something I can convert, which makes the building worse there. Now, some good news back in Attalia is that actually both the provinces that Saphrax was hoping would rebel have been captured by rebels. So, even though it looked like I might only get Neapolis, it seems I'm going to get Regium as well. Regium is the more important one, being part of the same province as Tarentum, so we're going to head there right away. The army there is not all that rubbish. It's got a few heavy troops in it and isn't as tiny as it could be, but the balance bar is so far in our favour, we're just going to completely demolish them and take the town for ourselves. Easy peasy. So now we've got a second province in Tarentum, which is going to be very helpful for controlling the spread of religion and sorting out the sanitation. Obviously, we're going to need to repair this place up, and one of the first orders of business here is going to be to get rid of the sacred groves that the Saxons built in order to spread Germanic paganism. We definitely don't want that. If I repair the grove, I can then convert it to an Arian shrine, which will start spreading Arian Christianity, which is more like it. It also has some Roman sanitation buildings, which are going to be very useful because they are better than the barbarian ones that I have available. Now moving on, Macedonia come back with another offer. They want me to pay them in exchange for peace. Quite a cheeky move considering the balance of power between our factions. So I come back with a real offer there of making them my tributary state for peace. They come back and ask for a white peace, but I'm not going to take this. I'm going to continue to support my ally, the Dacians, by keeping the war going. So now in the next turn, Amalric is scouting out the Eastern Roman Empire's territory in Egypt. These are going to be the next on Vithericus' hit list, and it looks like they're not really defending them, so it should be quite easy. I can't attack them right now, either of the two. I'm going to go to the right first and take the coastal province and then move up the Nile towards Alexandria, the capital of that province, and of course, one of the jewel cities of the entire Mediterranean world. I have the option of moving across the desert to get there a little bit sooner, but it doesn't mean I can attack this turn, and of course moving across the desert isn't a good idea in general, so I'll stick to the road. Just move most of the way for now. Next time I'll have the movement points I'll need to take out the Romans. You can see they do have a small force garrison there, but it's not going to be anything that Vithericus can't handle at this point. Amalric heads north to see Alexandria. There's no garrison in the city itself, so it should be pretty easy, it looks like, to take the rest of that province. Back over in Attalia, Saphrax has the opportunity to take Neapolis. You can see here there's two Illyrian armies that are moving south that look like they might be coming down to take it for themselves. Unfortunately, I can't attack the town this turn, I can just get close. So that means these Illyrian armies are going to have a chance before me to move in and take it, which would be a shame, but at least I've got the one I wanted more, Regium. So I'm just going to stand next to it, make it pretty obvious what I'm trying to do there. Perhaps as my ally they'll let me take it, you never know. In Regium itself, I can build that shrine I mentioned, so soon we'll be able to stabilize public order a bit more by getting more Arian Christians into the population. Because public order is a massive issue right now, I need to recruit another army, and I decided that Edgica is finally going to have his own force. He's been sitting on the sidelines for a long time, but now he's going to help me out by garrisoning Tarentum. I give him a few generic forces, including some hurlers, nice and cheap to upkeep for sitting in a garrison army. I'm going to call his force the Sentinels of Arius, the first new army that we've built in this entire campaign so far in. I'm also going to recruit a priestess back down in Ethiopia. I can use these to help the spread of Arian Christianity in the region, which is what I really need. Curiously, this priestess is called Vithericus, which I noticed is the same name as Gylamir's wife and Vithericus' sister, but I'm pretty sure it's not supposed to be the same one. So now moving on, the Eastern Roman Empire forces that were looking like they were going to defend against Vithericus' advance rush away and just flee into the corner there, so it seems Vithericus is going to have an even easier job. We also learn that our Italian allies who had moved west, perhaps to attack Iberia, are being completely destroyed by the Western Roman Empire. You can see they've taken Palma there, but the Western Roman Empire have just wiped them out, so they might not keep that for very long. How shall we equip our kingdom's last surviving prince? How about we round up some local outcasts too poor to buy weapons, ask them to pick up a few stones, and present them to him as his grand army? And then, just because we really think he's a worthy prince, we shall ask him to use his unarmed thugs to make sure the Romans and the Goths don't kill too many of each other while everyone's sweetheart Saphrax is away winning glory he doesn't need. His cup overflows, while mine catches a few splashes. This is folly. Better to be no prince at all than to be a joke prince. If the Romans don't revolt or something soon, I'm going to have to hold some surprisingly realistic training exercises. With the Eastern Roman Empire having fled from before Vithericus' advance, he can make said advance and destroy the small number of garrison troops who apparently do not have the option to leave. So I'll just quickly auto-resolve to get rid of these guys and start our capture of the province of Egypt. The question is whether the Eastern Roman Empire will be able to field a full army or bring down more forces from other battlefronts in order to stop me from doing anything like this. They are still quite strong up in Asia Minor, where they're still fighting with my allies, Asia and Pontus, and there's a chance they'll be able to come down and help out, but because I'm quite isolated here, I'm expecting at this point to be able to just sweep through these territories and take them, although it's also possible the Sassanids will seek to get involved. The province itself that I've just taken, the region, isn't in the best of state. It wasn't a particularly valuable one. So I'm going to destroy some of the stuff I don't need and repair up some of the things that I will need. And of course, we're probably going to have public order problems here, but you can see that Arian Christianity has already spread quite a bit. It's the second most popular religion in the region, so that's going to be quite handy. Vithericus, my priestess, will eventually come up to help spread it. For now, I'm going to leave her in Ethiopia, but I'm going to put her right on the border so I can just move her across to start spreading Christianity north when I need it. So, back in Attalia, things have gone exactly as I wish. The Illyrian armies didn't take Neapolis for whatever reason. They're just standing there raiding. One of them is, and the other one seems to have disappeared. So, Saphrax is going to take his leave to go and capture that town for himself, branching out into a new province now, moving north. So we are almost definitely going to have public order and religion issues up here, separate to the ones in Tarentum. So we could be facing multiple rebellions if we're not careful, just like the Saxons just did. But at least this province has Rome in it, and a desolate Rome. But the idea of taking Rome and rebuilding it is now definitely on the table, especially because I'm spectacularly rich right now. I'm going to start building up this little town here. It has some interesting Roman military buildings, which I'm going to be able to use to build Roman units. So that's going to be quite useful. I want to repair these military jetties, but I'm not going to keep them. I plan to convert them over to something else. I'm probably going to need fishing jetties here, actually, because there's actually a bit of a food problem, which we'll see in a moment. So Saphrax will now sit in his new home and watch public order decline before his advance. Since I just took regions in two new provinces, I need to assign governors to each province. I have not actually that many options to choose from, but luckily I did have two suitable candidates for each. I was checking out at first the other candidates outside of the main group of characters, but I decided not to go with them. What I'm going to do is I'm going to make Vidimir, Vithericus's son, the governor in Egyptus. So he's basically rolled in and installed his son as the ruler of these newly captured Roman lands. So hopefully his son will live up to Vithericus's expectations. Meanwhile, back in Italia, Theudis is going to become the governor of what is now Neapolis, but could one day be Rome. We learn now that there is a food shortage in Italia, which makes sense because there aren't any food-producing buildings in this region. So we're going to need to deal with that, which will be easy enough by converting over the military wharf into a fishing one. But before we look at that, I wanted to see the Roman units we have available. You can see, as well as Comitatensis Spears, I can recruit Legio and a heavier version, these Protectores. They're pretty powerful units, but the question is, are they actually any better or any more viable than just fielding a whole bunch of Gothic warband, as I've been doing so far? Because we have seen Roman heavy infantry get destroyed in many engagements when the Gothic warband just charge in and take them out. I think the Roman infantry in general have good staying power. They're not very good at fighting, but they have good armor and health, so will hold the line for a long time. So I might try and use them in battle. I think they would be a useful tactical component. So I'm going to start building those fishing jetties that I'll need, and hopefully Neapolis will then have the food shortage resolved. And the other thing I can do, of course, is just go and rebuild Rome. This will give me more building slots to play with in the long run, so we can sort the province out. And it means we'll now own the capital of the ancient world, which is, of course, quite a good achievement, considering we just started our new kingdom a few years ago. So we'll move in. It uses more than half of my army to settle the area and the majority of my money, but there wasn't much else I wanted to spend it on. Building Rome is definitely worth it. So I'm going to use the rest of my money to start rebuilding the city properly after having settled it. So in a few turns, the city will spring back to life. And Saphrax will find himself in command of a historically important but economically quite useless city in his new kingdom. I've renamed it to Novaeum, named after the homeland of the Gothic people, or at least this strand of the Gothic people back up in Eastern Europe. So Saphrax now waits. You can see the public order is declining rapidly. A chance of a rebellion is definitely going to be pretty high in the coming turns, but of course the chance of us defeating that rebellion is sufficiently high that I'm not worried at all about it. For Vithericus, he is going to move right on. He is going to leave the Roman town behind to have its own public order problems, as you can see. I have a new construction slot, but I've used all my money back up in Rome, so I can't do anything right now, so I'll have to wait to get this province management going. The Romans are pretty much going to be unable, by the looks of it, to stop our advance towards Alexandria. And of course, once we've captured that, we will have got a good deal of the way towards fulfilling our goal of capturing all of Africa. So check back to see how I'm getting on with that in the next episode. Vithericus keeps pushing to capture God's new lands in the next episode of The Second Messiah. We're still holding on to Tarentum, which is now pretty stable, and I'm thinking of moving out to take a new territory. My prime candidate is Syracuse, down to the southwest. It's part of the same province of Tarentum, so taking it will help me manage the public order, squalor, and food. And of course, there's no enemies around me here in Tarentum, so I should be free to move and attack that province, even though it's a little bit far away. Moving Saphrax out of the town does mean public order is deteriorating here as well, so I can't be gone for too many turns, or at least I need to capture Syracuse and secure public order there. To get to Syracuse easily, I need military access with the Saxons, because they control the land between me and them. Unfortunately, there's no chance of military access by the looks of it, so I'm willing to offer money for this because it would be awfully convenient, but the small amount I'm willing to offer doesn't seem to impress them. I offer a non-aggression pact out of interest, and they say no. So this isn't a very good sign, considering the Saxons have a pretty strong holding here in Italia, and they don't seem to like me. So I might have to be a little bit careful about how I treat the Saxons. But of course, Syracuse being a coastal city is reachable without using any of the Saxon land. I can go by boat. That might take a little bit longer, but we can still get there in two turns. And that should be enough, possibly, to avoid a rebellion if we're very lucky. So Saphrax is going to try. He needs a new campaign to give him a new lease of life and to expand the influence of the Goths, who are still really teetering on the edge. I can curiously here upgrade my cavalry to a superior version. Even while at sea, they managed to somehow scavenge the equipment and training resources they needed to do that. Interesting. So Syracuse itself is not in the best of shape, but it's likely very easy to capture at least. So now at the start of the next turn, there is indeed a rebellion in Ethiopia, and Garlamir has a new child, very useful. Euthyric is trying to get himself onto the one of the offices, the political ladder, and I don't think Vithericus, who seems to have the opportunity to block him, would really be up for this. Of course, in my own storyline, Vithericus doesn't even know that this is happening, so we'll have to imagine it's actually Saphrax attempting to block him, but I'm going to go for the block. Euthyric is not going to be allowed up the ranks of the Goths. Now, you might remember Edgica was trying to find a wife, and he appears to have located one. She's intelligent, giving a bunch of really useful traits, and they're the same age as well, so it looks like a pretty good match for these two, so I'm going to allow them to marry. So here's the rebellion. It's just east of New Eden, a pretty inconvenient location because I'm going to have to go away from my objective of Nobatia in order to fight it. So Vithericus is simply going to march over there and challenge them to battle. I knew they would run away from this because there's no reason for them to fight, and indeed they run into the mountains further east. Now at this point I could continue to chase them down, but it's in my interest actually to allow this rebellion to grow a bit larger. It does have some good looking units in there, but still it's so numerically inferior to me it's not a problem. But allowing the rebellion to grow larger will improve public order by another 20, meaning if I defeat it next turn we'll be on minus 60 public order rather than minus 80 where we would be if I defeated them now. So I'm going to allow them to grow, still should be able to just auto-resolve to kill them and get that free public order. And with that public order buffer there, I might even be able to avoid another rebellion if we're very lucky. You can see here my work converting this province to Arian Christianity is going quite well. The influence of Arian Christianity is massive, so the people are being converted very quickly, so hopefully that will help out with the public order in the future.
The tyrant king of the north came to our city with one purpose: to enslave a people who he regarded as mere insects beneath his feet. He brought with him his stinking followers, forcing them into our homes, bringing death and foul disease to our families. Now, he seeks to rebuild the city by his own vile plan, sparing no thought for the tens of thousands who called it home. How can any man see all these and not know it is time to fight for a righteous cause? How can anyone stand by and let a sacrilegious monster rule over such an honorable city? How can we forgive anyone who does not take up arms and fight with me to restore our pride, our integrity, and our freedom?
Switching back to Attalia, you can see Saphrax is too late to take Syracuse. It seems that our Italian allies have gone and taken it, perhaps even with help from the Visigoths there. So it looks like I was just slightly too late. One turn earlier and that province would have been mine. Everyone else had the same idea, seeing the weakness of Syracuse. I could move even further west to attempt to take another Western Roman Empire settlement, but the problem there is that I'll definitely face a rebellion back in Tarentum. Hello and welcome to episode 10 of The Second Messiah. On the last episode, Vithericus was conquering more territory from the Kingdom of Aksum, defeating their large naval force which landed at their last stronghold with relative ease by cutting them off before they could reach the town and then conquering the rest of their territory. Back in Attila with Saphrax, the Romans have been pretty much pushed off the peninsula. Now it's a massive patchwork of different factions vying for control of the region. Vithericus had to head back south to deal with an invasion by the Kingdom of Nobatia. Unfortunately for the enemy, they brought a very unversatile force and were able to be tempted into attacking uphill against Vithericus' superior infantry. Overall, the situation went very well for Vithericus and his army. The invasion was wiped out, and he now plans a counterattack.
You probably think I'm afraid of dying. The truth is that death would be a welcome release from this mess if I were just a common man. But as it stands, the mess my people are in is one I have led them to, and I'll be damned if I'm going to leave them in it. I need my strength back, strength enough for a campaign. We need to secure lands beyond our walls or we'll forever live in fear of destruction. And you know, thinking about being on the march again, walking side by side with my warriors, knowing that they'll do all it takes to see my mission completed. Just the thought makes me feel better already. Yes, I have to do something. At least try to go out with a bang. I can't let little weasel Eutheric think he controls the place. The more lands outside of Tarentum we hold, the more lands will be in the hands of true Goths, not the disgraced Romans. He thinks he deserves his power, but if it weren't for the sake of keeping the peace, I would have his head. I can't believe I let him fool me into thinking it was possible to take their empire for myself. Well, as I said, the least I can do is end my life doing something that makes the struggle of my people easier. That is what His Highness Vithmiris would have wanted, and perhaps, if he is alive, what Vithericus would want as well.
So Vithericus has defeated the Nobatian invasion. It was a pretty easy victory, you might remember. Their king didn't give them the best of commands and they lost most of their men very rapidly. Our force coming off looking okay. Plus, we're going to get really good replenishment by taking on warriors from the survivors. Unfortunately, the enemy's army wasn't totally destroyed, so we'll have to use up a few more movement points to finish them off. Should be easy, though. We can just auto-resolve that. The defeat of this army means that as far as we know, and as far as is likely, the Nobatians are now destroyed in terms of their military power. So unless they happen to have another army defending their settlement, we should be free to make an attack and thus unify the region of Ethiopia. You can see for this battle, interestingly, Guy Lemay is taking his first steps onto the battlefield, bringing out some Roman troops from the city. He commands Legio. Because the Ostrogoths are the inheritors of Rome, that's one of their traits, we are able to command a few Roman troops, and they're often in the garrisons. So there we go. The Nobatian army is wiped out, and will now be ready to move back north to attack them. I have Amalric, our spy, just there to the north, who should be able to go and take a look and find out if they do have any more forces. I'm assuming they won't. There's their town up there. It's a couple of turns of movement away, so it's even possible they'll build up something before I get there, if they have the money to do so. So moving through the desert, we don't encounter any more forces. Even right up to the city, there's nothing. So unless their armies happen to be somewhere else, it looks like their town's going to be undefended. I can just march right to it with Vithericus. The problem is that the territory we're leaving behind isn't in a very good state. New Eden is currently plagued by disease, and you can see public order is deteriorating from its already low state, meaning we're extremely likely to face a rebellion after this turn. The people are not happy about this new state of affairs. We're forcing Arian Christianity on them as well, which they're probably not too enthusiastic about. So depending on where the rebel army spawns, this may affect my ability to go and attack the Nobatians, because I might have to, say, move south first to take out the rebels, which could be inconvenient. You can see that some of the Eastern-style buildings here are actually better than the ones I can convert them to, so I'm going to just conveniently leave a lot of them as they are in order to get some sanitation boosts there. So now back to Saphrax in Attali while I'm away. So that's not really going to be a possibility. Saphrax is going to have to return empty-handed and embarrassed to his people just in order to keep things under control back here. We do have lots of construction going on, so the level of public order should slowly even out as our buildings get completed. So now the rebel army has grown indeed bigger, it's time for Vithericus to challenge it again. This time it actually stands and fights despite having a massive disadvantage still. That's convenient for me because it means it uses fewer movement points to finish these guys off, and of course a quick auto-resolve should finish them. There we go, entire army destroyed. I actually somehow lost an entire squad of my phalanxmen, which is unfortunate, but at least they were only a mercenary unit, so losing them at least has some financial benefits. So with them defeated, public order is now going to start to increase. Vithericus can move back to Edulis in order to further increase public order for this turn, and then next turn he'll be able to start moving west and north towards the Nobatian capital, which Amalric reports still has no forces in it. It's very curious, the Nobatians aren't bothering to actually rebuild their army after having lost it. Perhaps they've already given up hope. Has some interesting looking buildings, it'll be very nice to add to Ethiopia and help out with the general management of the province. Now, moving back to Attalia, Saphrax doesn't have much to do anymore. He just has to wait. He's sitting here trying to control public order. Sanitation's a possible issue, so a Tarentum 2 may face disease at any moment. I am improving sanitation with my new construction, so that's going to improve over time. Unfortunately, Syracuse, which would have helped with the sanitation, isn't going to be ours. The other choice is to take Saxon territory. If we move southwest and take that town Regium, then we'll be able to use that to start improving this province and stop them from converting it to Germanic paganism, which appears to be what they're trying to do down there. For Vithericus, with his turn resting at Edulis over, it's time to move out. You can see public order is still improving even with him outside of the town, so that's excellent news. I can make the situation better by upgrading the town centre I've built at New Eden to further improve public order. We have plenty of food at the moment, so that's not going to be an issue, adding to the food consumption. So it looks like Vithericus, as he is 3 turns of regular marching away from his target. I can use forced march to get a little bit closer than I would have done in 1 turn otherwise, so that if I switch back to a regular march in the next turn, I can reach it then. That will stop the Nobatians from recruiting anything, but since it looks like they're not going to, I don't necessarily need to do this. But of course, no reason to wait around. He has a free space in his army, so I was considering hiring some mercenaries. I ended up deciding to go with the camel warriors, because we've seen before, whilst fighting them, they're pretty powerful. We've been quite lucky, actually, in managing to defeat them with missile units, but in melee, they're very good, and especially good as anti-cavalry units. So I thought it might be nice to have that specialist unit in the army alongside my cavalry, as long as my own cav aren't too freaked out by it. So I'm going to hire them in for the attack. Not that I actually need it, but I have so much money that I'm considering hiring these mercenaries in and just keeping them as specialist units. For Saphrax, I had pretty much decided at this point that I was probably just going to attack the Saxons, just drive them out of Attalia and secure the area around me. Their home base is still back up in Saxony itself, so it's unlikely they'll be able to reinforce very easily these little colonies they've taken. The problem with that plan is that Saxons have diplomatic ties. You can see they have 2 defensive allies and a military ally, so declaring war on them could be a little bit dangerous. First, I offered a non-aggression pact just to see if they would actually accept that resolution to our little conflict here, and the chance was low, so it seems they're getting more and more angry with me, or perhaps vice versa. So something is going to have to happen, but if I declare war on them, I'll be called in, their allies will be called in to fight me, unless I can join the Western Roman Empire's war against the Saxons. Using that method, I won't have to fight their allies, and I'll actually get peace with the Western Roman Empire, because I'll have to get peace to do that. Unfortunately, there was no deal where they'll accept peace with me, so all of my missions here have basically failed. I can't go to war with the Saxons legitimately. However, I decided to just trespass in their lands to see what was going on, and noticed that their province is experiencing a rebellion. So it's quite possible that the rebels will take the settlement. I can just sit back in Tarentum and wait, and once it's a rebel province, I can go and take it for myself without having to actually start anything with the Saxons. I'm going to get rid of my mercenaries while I wait to do that and see if that plan works. During the end turn sequence, the Macedonians, who I've been at war with for a long time, supporting my allies the Dacians, who have been attacked by them over and over again, offered me a peace treaty. I was willing to accept it if they gave me a sufficient amount of money, because you can see they're a very weak faction, and they're not a particularly stable faction politically. It seems likely they'll end up going to war with us again. So I ended up actually just saying, no, I'm not going to be at peace with you. I'm going to continue to support my Dacian allies, because the Dacians did actually help me take Tarentum in Attalia. They've been quite useful as an ally. So we're now in the next turn. Saphrax moves out, only to discover the rebel army is gone. I don't know whether it attacked the town and failed or whether it just walked off somewhere. There's no way of knowing at this point. But it does mean I shouldn't really get my hopes up by the looks of it. That regime is going to be captured by rebels anytime soon. Now, almost on a whim, I moved north and discovered that Neapolis also has a rebellion. This is a different province, so it actually is rebelling separately to regime. So I might actually have a chance to take Neapolis, and at least that will be something.
Chief Saphrax, I can report that everything is in place. Huthric agreed to the plan, thinking he'll get moved to Neapolis, closer to Rome. Fool. He wants to govern that pile of rubble so bad it is hilarious to see his face when you tell him it's going to happen. Anyway, the weapons and money have been sent. We've got people in every town gathering support for a Roman revival under the protection of you, my lord. The Saxons have only a handful of men, no hope to stop the rebellion once the army gathers. One thing though, it took a lot of work and a lot of my own money to make this happen. I hope that you will see fit to reward me if this all goes as I claim it will.
Now Vithericus is ready to make his advance. He can get there in one turn of normal stance, rushing up the road there to Pacarus, where he can just destroy the small garrison inside using a protective stance. So, just like that, we've wiped out the surviving elements of the Nobatian kingdom and made them our own. I'll occupy the territory, unifying the province of Ethiopia. We've got all three of the regions now. The town needs a little bit of repair, but otherwise the buildings here are quite useful ones. We'll be able to use some of these to help with our sanitation. Especially in the cases where actually converting the buildings would make things worse off, so a lot of that town's going to remain the same. The bad news though is that in the next turn the disease from New Eden spreads north, so the province of Ethiopia is rapidly being consumed by this disease, and it's not particularly helpful, certainly a bad omen for the people to see this disease spreading. Well, we've got the entire province under control, so at least we have the ability to control the sanitation entirely now. We've got lots of space to use, and the sanitation is generally positive as a result of the buildings. You can see here's another example of something I can convert, which makes the building worse there. Now, some good news back in Attalia is that actually both the provinces that Saphrax was hoping would rebel have been captured by rebels. So, even though it looked like I might only get Neapolis, it seems I'm going to get Regium as well. Regium is the more important one, being part of the same province as Tarentum, so we're going to head there right away. The army there is not all that rubbish. It's got a few heavy troops in it and isn't as tiny as it could be, but the balance bar's so far in our favour, we're just going to completely demolish them and take the town for ourselves. Easy peasy. So now we've got a second province in Tarentum, which is going to be very helpful for controlling the spread of religion and sorting out the sanitation. Obviously, we're going to need to repair this place up, and one of the first orders of business here is going to be to get rid of the sacred groves that the Saxons built in order to spread Germanic paganism. We definitely don't want that. If I repair the grove, I can then convert it to an Arian shrine, which will start spreading Arian Christianity, which is more like it. It also has some Roman sanitation buildings, which are going to be very useful because they are better than the barbarian ones that I have available. Now moving on, Macedonia come back with another offer. They want me to pay them in exchange for peace. Quite a cheeky move considering the balance of power between our factions. So I come back with a real offer there of making them my tributary state for peace. They come back and ask for a white peace. But I'm not going to take this. I'm going to continue to support my ally, the Dacians, by keeping the war going. So now in the next turn, Amalric is scouting out the Eastern Roman Empire's territory in Egypt. These are going to be the next on Vithericus's hit list, and it looks like they're not really defending them, so it should be quite easy. I can't attack them right now, either of the two. I'm going to go to the right first and take the coastal province and then move up the Nile towards Alexandria, the capital of that province, and of course one of the jewel cities of the entire Mediterranean world. I have the option of moving across the desert to get there a little bit sooner, but it doesn't mean I can attack this turn, and of course moving across the desert isn't a good idea in general, so I'll stick to the road. Just move most of the way for now. Next time I'll have the movement points I'll need to take out the Romans. You can see they do have a small force garrison there, but it's not going to be anything that Vithericus can't handle at this point. Amalric heads north to see Alexandria. There's no garrison in the city itself, so it should be pretty easy, looks like, to take the rest of that province. Back over in Attalia, Saphrax has the opportunity to take Neapolis. You can see here there's two Illyrian armies that are moving south that look like they might be coming down to take it for themselves. Unfortunately, I can't attack the town this turn, I can just get close. So that means these Illyrian armies are going to have a chance before me to move in and take it, which would be a shame, but at least I've got the one I wanted more, Regium. So I'm just going to stand next to it, make it pretty obvious what I'm trying to do there. Perhaps as my ally they'll let me take it, you never know. In Regium itself, I can build that shrine I mentioned, so soon we'll be able to stabilize public order a bit more by getting more Aryan Christians into the population. Because public order is a massive issue right now, I need to recruit another army, and I decided that Edgica is finally going to have his own force. He's been sitting on the sidelines for a long time, but now he's going to help me out by garrisoning Tarentum. I give him a few generic forces, including some hurlers nice and cheap to upkeep for sitting in a garrison army. I'm going to call his force the Sentinels of Arius, the first new army that we've built in this entire campaign so far in. I'm also going to recruit a priestess back down in Ethiopia. I can use these to help the spread of Aryan Christianity in the region, which is what I really need. Curiously, this priestess is called Vithericus, which I notice is the same name as Gylamir's wife and Vithericus's sister, but I'm pretty sure it's not supposed to be the same one. So now moving on, the Eastern Roman Empire forces that were looking like they were going to defend against Vithericus' advance rush away and just flee into the corner there, so it seems Vithericus is going to have an even easier job. We also learn that our Italian allies who had moved west, perhaps to attack Iberia, are being completely destroyed by the Western Roman Empire. You can see they've taken Palma there, but the Western Roman Empire have just wiped them out, so they might not keep that for very long. How shall we equip our kingdom's last surviving prince? How about we round up some local outcasts too poor to buy weapons, ask them to pick up a few stones, and present them to him as his grand army? And then, just because we really think he's a worthy prince, we shall ask him to use his unarmed thugs to make sure the Romans and the Goths don't kill too many of each other while everyone's sweetheart Saphrax is away winning glory he doesn't need. His cup overflows, while mine catches a few splashes. This is folly. Better to be no prince at all than to be a joke prince. If the Romans don't revolt or something soon, I'm going to have to hold some surprisingly realistic training exercises. With the Eastern Roman Empire having fled from before Vithericus' advance, he can make said advance and destroy the small number of garrison troops who apparently do not have the option to leave. So I'll just quickly auto-resolve to get rid of these guys and start our capture of the province of Egypt. The question is whether the Eastern Roman Empire will be able to field a full army or bring down more forces from other battlefronts in order to stop me from doing anything like this. They are still quite strong up in Asia Minor, where they're still fighting with my allies, Asia and Pontus, and there's a chance they'll be able to come down and help out, but because I'm quite isolated here, I'm expecting at this point to be able to just sweep through these territories and take them, although it's also possible the Sassanids will seek to get involved. The province itself that I've just taken, the region, sorry, isn't in the best of state. It wasn't a particularly valuable one. So I'm going to destroy some of the stuff I don't need and repair up some of the things that I will need. And of course, we're probably going to have public order problems here, but you can see that Aryan Christianity has already spread quite a bit. It's the second most popular religion in the region, so that's going to be quite handy. Vithericus, my priestess, will eventually come up to help spread it. For now, I'm going to leave her in Ethiopia, but I'm going to put her right on the border so I can just move her across to start spreading Christianity north when I need it. So, back in Attalia, things have gone exactly as I wished. The Illyrian armies didn't take Neapolis for whatever reason. They're just standing there raiding. One of them is, and the other one seems to have disappeared. So, Saphrax is going to take his leave to go and capture that town for himself, branching out into a new province now, moving north. So we are almost definitely going to have public order and religion issues up here, separate to the ones in Tarentum. So we could be facing multiple rebellions if we're not careful, just like the Saxons just did. But at least this province has Rome in it, and a desolate Rome. But the idea of taking Rome and rebuilding it is now definitely on the table, especially because I'm spectacularly rich right now. I'm going to start building up this little town here. It has some interesting Roman military buildings, which I'm going to be able to use to build Roman units. So that's going to be quite useful. I want to repair these military jetties, but I'm not going to keep them. I plan to convert them over to something else. I'm probably going to need fishing jetties here, actually, because there's actually a bit of a food problem, which we'll see in a moment. So Saphrax will now sit in his new home and watch public order decline before his advance. Since I just took regions in two new provinces, I need to assign governors to each province.